Good evening, everyone. We welcome you all to Ortho TV Online, Nucoxia Digitalk series. And to introduce today's topic and speaker, I hand over to our moderator, Dr. Salim Patel.
Thanks, Dr. Neeraj. A very good evening to all our viewers. This is our first webinar for the year 2021. And to start with it, we are starting with a very important and a known topic. But before I tell you about the topic, let me introduce to you our today's speaker. He's none other than our respected Dr. Rajesh Gupta, sir. A senior orthopedic surgeon from Jammu. He's a professor and head of orthopedics at ASCOMS and Hospital Jammu. He has done his fellowship in arthroscopy at the AIIMS New Delhi, as well as a fellowship in sports medicine at the SGH Hospital in Singapore. He's been the president of the Jammu and Kashmir Orthopedic Association, a member of the Rural and Social Orthopedics, as well as the IOA. And today, sir, is with us to talk upon a very interesting topic, which is important right from the beginning of your career as an orthopedic surgeon till you keep on practicing. It's about the principles of plaster application. With this, I would hand over the session to Dr. Rajesh, sir. Over to you, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much for the nice words. So with this, I will start my talk. Okay, is visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is a very, important talk for the postgraduates, for the orthopedic surgeons who are working in the rural areas and for all of us. Now, we know that most of us are, forgetting this art of plastering, to treat the fracture conservatively. So let us revise few things. Now, we all know that plaster application is a technical skill. And as we require practice to sharpen our surgical skills, we also need to practice, how to apply a plaster properly. And to apply a plaster properly, we should have the knowledge of its basic principles. And if these principles are not followed, then we may land up in risks and complications. Now, before applying any plaster cast, we have to assess the extremity for the displacement of the fractures, for any abrasions, wounds, and the neurovascular status. It is very important. And if the need is felt to have a plaster, we must decide whether the patient needs a splint or a cast. Now, casts and splints, they mainly serve to immobilize the orthopedic injuries. And the main function is to align the bone, to decrease the pain, to protect the injury, to promote the heal, and to compensate for the surrounding muscle weakness. And the main indication is the treatment of the fractures. It is also used in the treatment of sprains, soft tissue injuries, tendon lacerations, some inflammatory conditions to give rest to the part like arthritis, tendinopathies, tendinitis, etc. And also used to correct the deformities. Now, we all know that, what is plaster of Paris? Plaster of Paris is a hemihydrated form of the calcium sulfate. And when we wet it, it becomes hydrated calcium sulfate and the heat is released. It is known as exothermic reaction. So there are stages of plaster application. The first stage involves the application of POP slab or the cast. Second stage, also known as the setting stage, here there's a change of POP to gypsum and it is defined as the time taken to form rigid dressing after contact with water. Third stage or the green stage is just set wet cast. The fourth stage, also known as cast drying, is evaporation of excess of water when the cast dries. And this results in a mature cast with multiple air pockets through which the skin breathes. Now, there are many factors which influence the plastering. We will be discussing them one by one. The first is the temperature. When we immerse the plaster bandage in a cold water, the initial set of the bandage is delayed, and thereby the working length is increased. It is indicated when we are manipulated the fracture fragments within the plaster cast while applying the plaster, so that at least we can feel the fracture fragments and we want to hold the fracture for a while in a reduced position. If we immerse the plaster bandage in a warm water, there will be a rapid set of the bandage. Now, coming to strength, the interlocking of the crystals formed is essential to the strength and the rigidity of the cast. The interlocking of the crystals, that is also known as critical setting period, begins when the plaster reaches the thick, creamy stage, becomes a little rubbery, and starts losing its wet, shiny appearance. So the motion during the critical setting period interferes with this interlocking process and reduces the ultimate strength by as much as 77%. So while applying a plaster cast, we have to hold the extremity in an immobile position during the setting period. If we keep on moving the extremity of the patient, the plaster will take a longer time to set and we end up in applying more bandages and the plaster becomes heavy. So the cast drying occurs by evaporation of the water. The evaporation from the cast surface is influenced by air temperature, humidity, and circulation about the cast. Thick casts take longer to dry than the thinner ones, and the strength increases as drying occurs. Coming to padding, padding protects the skin and the soft tissue during cast removal, and it also protects the skin from thermal injury. The poor padding will lead to pressure sores, and over padding will lead to loose cast. So padding has to be appropriate. So when we are applying a plaster bandage, we should not compress the padding by more than 50%. Incorporation, the plaster bandage in a wet stage is infinitely moldable, and it can be set around cast brace, hinges, and walking heels. But for maximum strength, when we are applying these walking appliances, we apply few layers of the plaster bandage in the extremity and then let it set a bit, let it dry a bit. And after it is done, then we apply these walking appliances with a fresh layer of the plaster bandage. If we don't do that, and if you apply these appliances on a wet cast, it will indent the cast, thereby leading to pressure sores. So coming to absorption, the excess exudates from inside and moisture from outside will weaken the cast and cast will break prematurely. Now time, the strength of the POP builds up over a period of time. We all know that it takes around 48 to 72 hours for a plaster to get completely dry. And we should not allow the patient to wear bed before that time. Okay. We need a few things while applying a plaster cast, like POP bandage, fiberglass, crepe bandage, cotton bandages, casting gloves, basin of water, bandage scissor, padding material, sheets, stockinette, adhesive tape. Now, stockinette comes in different sizes. For finger, it is around 1 inch. For upper extremity, 2 to 3 inches. And for lower extremity, 3 to 4 inches. Now, padding also comes in different sizes. For hand and feet, it is around 2 inches. For upper extremity, 2 to 3 inches. And for lower extremity, 4 to 6 inches. POP also comes in different sizes. For hand and feet, it is 2 to 3 inches. For upper extremity, 3 to 4 inches. And for lower extremity, 4 to 6 inches. Now, synthetic cast also comes in different sizes. For hand and feet, again, 2 to 3 inches. For upper extremity, 3 to 4 inches. And for lower extremities, 4 to 5 inches. There's no 6 inches bandage in a synthetic cast. Now, coming to pattern of application, what is a slab? It is a POP encloses partial circumference of the limb. What is a cast? Here, POP encloses the full circumference of the limb. Spica includes trunk and or one or more limbs. And what is brace? It is splintage which can allow motion at the adjacent joints. Now, coming to interposition material, the cast can be applied unpadded. Unpadded means there is no material is interposed between POP and the skin. And it was practiced by Bowler, and Sir Charnley also recommended its use in the treatment of Colles fractures, scaphoid, and Bennett fractures. The plea given by them was it rigidly fixes the fracture. But the disadvantage is it is difficult to remove and does not compensate for the swelling. So the current practice is to use padded cast. and the interposed material may be stuck in it and wool or wool alone. Now we will be discussing each of these slabs cast one by one. So slab is a temporary splint used in the initial stages of fracture treatment, in first aid, in the postoperative period, and in infections to give rest to the part. It is made up of half by POP and half by the bandage roll, and hence can accommodate the swelling in the initial stages of the fracture. So it is prepared according to the required length. Now there are three methods of applying slab. One is a dry method. Here the slab is prepared first and then dipped in water. It is commonly implied method. What is wet method? Here the slab is prepared after dipping the POP roll in the water. Here the POP roll is made wet first and then we prepare the slab. This is a rare and requires experience. Pattern method, here slabs are fashioned in the desired way before dipping it in water. Now there are many ways in which splinting can be accomplished, and slab is one of that. And how to apply a proper slab, I'm going to show you a video. Now, okay, so whenever we have to apply a slab or a cast, we have to mark the extent of the slab proximally and distally. Okay, after marking, we take some powder for a soothing action. Now take an appropriate size stockinette. Roll it over the extremity. Now important thing here is it should extend around 8 to 10 centimeter beyond the marked level. And second important thing is there should not be any wrinkles in the stockinette. It has to be very, very smooth. So these are two very important things while applying a stockinette. Now we take an appropriate size cotton and start applying it from distal to proximal, always from distal to proximal. And here again, it has to be applied very smoothly, and it should cover around 50% of the preceding layer, 50% of the preceding layer. Thereby, it gives two layers of the cotton. And we should extend around 2 to 3 centimeter beyond the marked level. Okay. So again, the important thing here is it has to be very, very smooth. It should not be applied in ugly lumps. Now, at the ends of the plaster, we apply some extra cotton so that sharp edges don't rub against the skin. Okay, and we apply some extra cotton at the bony prominences. Now, we take an already prepared slab. For upper extremity, we use around 6 to 10 layers, and for the lower extremity, we use 12 to 15 layers. Dip it in water, take out extra water, apply it to the extremity, and mold it to the contours of the extremity. You have to mold it to the contours of the extremity like this, okay? Now you have to hold the extremity in the position, whatever position you want. You ask the patient to do it, or your assistant is doing it, or you can do it yourself also. So after that, you take a wet cotton bandage and start applying it from distal to proximal, again from distal to proximal, maintaining the position, whatever position you want. Okay, so after you have done that, you hold the extremity for few minutes so that it sets a bit. Hold it in few minutes, no problem. You have to wait so that it sets. If you don't do it, keep on moving. As I have already told you, the plaster will take a longer time to set, and we'll end up in applying more bandages in case of the cast. Otherwise, the slab will never set and it will break. Now, this is important. I am, folding back the stockinette and the cotton so that the sharp edges, they don't irritate the skin leading to the pressure sores. That is why we keep few centimeters of stocking net and cotton long. Now, finishing job is done by this bandage, and we are done with the slab. So this is how a proper slab is applied. Now, second way to create a splint is without the use of stocking net or circumferential padding. Here, several layers of padding that are slightly wider and longer than the splint are applied directly to the smooth wet splint. Here, we don't use any stocking net or cotton padding. And together, they are molded to the extremity and secured with an elastic bandage. Now, there are pre-packaged splints consisting of fiberglass and padding wrapped in a mesh layer. These are easily cut and molded to the injured extremity. However, they are expensive and not always available. Now, there are also prefabricated and the over-the-counter splints available in the market. They are the simplest options, although they are less custom fit and their use may be limited by cost or availability. So this is splinting. Now coming to cast, here the POP completely encircles the limb. And as already told you, it is used as a definitive form of fracture treatment and also can correct the deformities. There are three methods of applying a POP cast. One is a skin tight cast. It is same as unpadded cast. Now Bologna cast, here generous amount of cotton padding is applied to the limb before putting the cast. And this is commonly implied method. Three tire cast, here stockiness is used first over which cotton padding is done before applying the POP cast. It is an ideal method, but little bit more expensive due to stockinette cast. Stockinette, you know. Spica encircles a part of the body in a figure of eight fashion. Example is hip spica for fracture on the hip and fracture shaft of the femur in children. Now, what is functional cast brace? It provides immobilization, but also promotes early activity and early joint motion. Now, coming to splinting versus casting, when considering whether to apply a splint or a cast, the physician must assess the stage and the severity of the injury, the potential for instability, the risk of complications, and the patient's functional requirements. Now, what are the advantages of splinting? The splinter use offers many advantages over casting. They are faster and easy to apply, maybe static or dynamic. Splints being non-circumferential allows for natural swelling that occurs during the initial inflammatory phase of the injury. It is a preferred method of immobilization in the acute care setting. It means in a fresh case, if there is a lot of swelling, we use splinting, we use slab, okay? And splint may be removed more easily than a cast, allowing for regular inspection of the injury site. What are the disadvantages? Lack of patient compliance and excessive motion at the injury site. And splints are inappropriate for a definitive care of the unstable or potentially unstable type of the injuries. Now, so casting is the mainstay of treatment for most fractures, and it provides more effective immobilization, but it requires more skill and time to apply and have a high risk of complication if not properly applied. Now, what are the alternatives to the POP? So most of these are fiberglass fabric impregnated with polyurethane resin, and pre-polymer is methylene bisphenyl diisoline, which converts to a non-toxic polymeric urea substitute. So they are lightweight, okay, they are more strong, they are radiolucent, they are, you know, comes in different colors, but we should not apply these things in a acute care things, you know, in a fresh fracture when we need molding. So molding is a problem in this type of the fiberglass bandages. So plaster has traditionally been preferred material for splints and cast. Is more pliable and has a lower setting time than fiberglass, allowing more time to apply and mold the material before it sets. Now, coming to rules guiding the POP use. The surgeon should examine the limb and the fracture site, documenting any skin lesion and neurovascular status. A radiograph should also be reviewed thoroughly to determine the fracture pattern. And the motion required to adequately reduce the fracture should be rehearsed ahead of the commencement of the procedure. POP should preferably be applied by the surgeon and not by the, you know, plaster room boy. Procedure requires at least one assistant. The plaster should be snugly fitting and should not be too tight or too loose. And there should be uniform thickness of the plaster. So this is the Wellington Wood effect, you know, if it is too loose and it is not applied uniformly. And very important, it should be molded with the palm and not with the fingers for fear of indentation leading to the pressure source. So as a general rule, immobilize one joint below and one above the reduced fracture, but there are exceptions. Joint should be immobilized in the functional position, very important. Always check for neurovascular status after cast application and do check X-ray for the acceptability of the reduction. Now there's another video. Now I'm showing how to apply a cast. Example is a scaphoid cast here. Now again, we have to mark the extent of the cast. As I have told you, while applying a slab. Now again, can apply some powder and then appropriate size tachinet. Again, important thing is it should extend 8 to 10 centimeter beyond the mark level, and there should not be any wrinkles. It has to be very, very smooth. So see the, it has to be very smooth. If it is not smooth, there are wrinkles in the cotton and the stuckinet, it will lead to pressure sores on the underlying skin. So take appropriate size cotton, start rolling it from distal to proximal. Same rule, it has to cover 50% of the preceding layer. Should not be applied in an ugly lumps like this. Should not fold it like this. It has to be very, very smooth. And it should extend 2 to 3 centimeter beyond the marked level. Again, apply some extra cotton at the ends and at the bony prominences. Okay, here at the ends. Again, we ask the patient to hold the limb in a particular position here. In a scaphoid cast, it is a cup holding position. Okay, the thumb should face the middle finger, and we should include the interphalangeal joint of the thumb in the cast. Now, take an appropriate side bandage, dip it in water. So let the bubbles come out, bubbles stop coming, take it out, hold it like this. You should hold the bandage at the end, you know, at the edge at its center. You should not hold it at either of the edges. So bandage has to be held at its end at the center and start applying from distal to proximal like this. It should not be very tight and it should not be very loose. See how I'm holding the plaster bandage. I'm holding with the fingers with my left hand. Now see, it has to be a rhythmic to and fro movement from distal to proximal. See here, see how my fingers are moving and my thinner eminence of the right hand is smoothing it out. So it has to be very, very rhythmic movement. So once you apply one bandage, again you smoothen out the plaster. Now why to do it? Because there are air pockets, and air pockets will lead to stress risers and the plaster will break, cast will break. So always important, whenever you apply a one bandage, smoothen it out so that the air comes out and there is a proper, you know, adhesion of the layers. Take second bandage, again start applying it from distal to proximal. Don't apply many layers at one place. Okay, don't like this. Don't apply many layers at one place. It has to be, you know, one layer at a time. See it again. I'll show you again. See here. You should not apply many layers at one place. Okay. So it has to be one layer at a time. Otherwise, it becomes, you know, thick at one place, thin at one place, and that also leads to stress riders and the plaster breaks early. So it has to be a uniform thickness, you know, all around. Now hold it for a few minutes. Always, as I told you, let it set a bit. Don't do any, you know, movement at this point. You have to maintain that position, whatever position you want. Okay, so there is no movement of the extremity at this point of the wrist or the thumb. Okay, now fold it back. So important thing is it should not irritate the skin at the extremities like this. Now we have to see the movement at the adjacent joint. It should not impinge in the below elbow or a scaphoid cast, usually two fingers below the flexion crease of the elbow, and then take a final bandage and finish out the things. So this is how a plaster cast is applied. Now, coming to a few important things. One is wedging of the plaster cast. In a fresh fracture, when there is an unacceptable loss of reduction and cast is well fitting, and if there is a, you know, angulatory deformity, we can treat that by doing wedging of the plaster. Usually it is done around 48 hours to 72 hours after the application of the plaster cast. Now, 2/3 of the circumference of the cast is cut at the concave surface of the deformity. It is opened, wedge is opened and held open with a corkscrew, okay, thereby correcting the deformity, and then we apply a fresh bandage to repair it. This is a fracture both bone, angulatory deformity corrected with the wedging. So this is how a wedging is done. And this is a fracture both bone, distal end corrected with the wedging. So wedging is a important, you know, procedure for the correction of the angulatory deformity, but it has to be done very precisely. Now, second important thing is a cast index. Now it is a ratio of sagittal to coronal width from inside the cast edges. Okay. Now A is a dimension in the lateral view and B is in the AP view. So cast index is A oblique B. Now the cross section of an appropriate forearm plaster should resemble an oval and not a circle. For optimum cast fitting in the distal forearm fracture treated, the sagittal to coronal ratio should be 0.7. It is different in different parts of the extremities. So for, you know, leg it is 1.2, for arm it is 1.3. So it is not same everywhere. So well-fitting plasters are important with any immobilized limb. So here is an example of forearm cast. It should look like oval and not round. If it is round, it means you have not molded it properly and you are going to lose your reduction. Now coming to third important principle, there are 3-point fixation. Now bones have a tensile surface and a compressile surface. So this is a convex surface and this is a convex surface. So this is a tensile and this is a compressile surface. Now whenever there is a fracture, the soft tissues will break on the convex side and it remains intact on the concave side. So when we do the reduction while applying these forces, this is force 1, 2, and 3, and maintain this reduction in a plaster cast, you are not going to lose the reduction. And if any of the forces removed, there is loss of reduction. See here, this is a soft tissue hinge When the fracture breaks because of bending, the soft tissue disrupts on the convex side and remains intact on the concave side. So when we do the reduction, the three-point fixation is applied and the fracture becomes stable. So the three-point fixation produces tension in the intact soft tissue. It produces compression across the fracture side to immobilize the fracture. It is needed for fractures which are unstable. So a straight cast will usually contain a crooked bone, but a curved cast will generally contain a well-aligned bone. So here, see the fracture here. It is reduced and it is well molded by three-point fixation. So it is a bent cast. It is not a straight cast. If it is a straight cast, it means you have not obtained three-point fixation principle. Now coming to aftercare, counsel the patient on signs of neurovascular compromise. Very important. Excessive pain, excessive swelling, bluish or white discoloration of the digits. And we have to tell the patient verbally and write on the prescription slip. If they are having any of these problems, they have to report immediately. Reinforce all cracks and weak areas with more POP locally. Limb elevation reduces swelling, pain, and risk of too tight cast. Check if the POP is restricting movements and ensure that all joints not immobilized by the cast have full range of motion. So whenever we apply a plaster cast, we advise the patient to keep the limb elevated and keep the fingers moving. Fingers are toes, the part which is outside the plaster cast. So keep the POP dry. Any area of localized pain should be windowed and it may be developing pressure sore. The patient should be reviewed in 1 to 2 weeks and x-rays done to reaffirm maintenance of the reduction. So most common casting errors are poor choice of cast type, failure to immobilize the joint above and below injury, redundancy and bunching in the cast liner or padding. I have already told you in detail. It is secondary to careless uneven application or extremity reposition after application with the resultant pressure points formation and skin breakdown. Excessive tight padding or cast material application, tight cast becomes too tight. Inadequate padding at the pressure points. Failure to extend the cast to appropriate proximal and distal levels. Poor molded technique with subsequent cast displacement or loss of reduction. Acceptance of suboptimal cast. So the conclusion is, despite revolutionary advances in the management of injury, especially those of musculoskeletal system, POP still remains very useful in carefully selected cases, obviating the need for unnecessary surgery with its attendant risks. Thank you very much. Okay. So, Dr. Salim, done with that?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So, we have a few questions for you.
No problem.
One basic question, sir. I mean, it was an excellent presentation, no doubt about it. Very crisp and up to the mark, and even explaining the basic techniques of applying a plaster.
It is all about basic. You know what? It is all about basics.
Right, sir. Absolutely. Absolutely, sir. So my question to you is in cases of ankle fractures, especially yes. when we immobilize it. Now, usually we give a posterior slab support temporarily after we converted into the cast over a period of time. Now, there was a slab in which we were taught how to put, in which instead of putting a posterior slab, we used to put a mediolateral clamp slab, where both the malleoli, the medial as well as the lateral malleoli would be stabilized, and the ankle would have been kept at 90 degrees so that there is proper support and the patient can be shifted easily. So,
see, perfectly, all right. Perfectly, there are many ways to do it, you know.
Right.
And this is the method, you know, being practiced by AO people.
Right, sir. Right, sir.
Right. So absolutely. They are doing, you know, on the both the side and also one posteriorly also.
Right, sir.
So this is perfectly all right. You can do it.
So it is like a circumferential protection, just like a permanent.
Yes, yes. They are doing it. This is all given in your book.
Right, sir. Right, sir. So yes, sir. The next question is, sir, about these new generation plasters.
Yes.
Especially those thermoelastic plasters and the new ones, which those openings are there. So your comments on that, would they really...
See, it is not openings, you know. It is basically the fiberglass, and now the new things coming is the polyesters.
Polyesters, right.
Yes. No, because they say that, you know, there's less dust while cutting it.
Absolutely.
Right. And one of the companies is, you know, promoting its products, you know, like a Delta Cast, you know, Delta Light, Delta Soft. There are many things, you know.
Right.
So I think there are advantages, a little bit like less of dusting, more is to remove, you know. And they have different composition for different things. They say for the, you know, ankle sprain, they have a Delta Soft, something like that. You know, there are different things coming up.
Right.
The thing you are talking about is that, you know, a 3D casting with the holes. That's a different thing.
Right.
That is a different thing. There's a Mumbai company, you know, I visited their stall in the Tramacans. They used to make it.
Right, sir. Right.
And I had a few discussion with them, you know. Yeah. And, you know, in I wanted to invite them in a few of our workshops in maybe next future, you know, somewhere we are doing it all over India, you know, the physical workshops. Now they're virtual going on. We have already done 7-8 workshops all over India. And we will invite them one day how to do that, because they this is all computerized.
Absolutely.
This is all, they take dimensions and then they make a model of that. And then they say it is very helpful, you know.
Right. So what are your comments on that? Do you prefer such clusters?
See, I have no experience yet. So, I have no experience yet. I have discussion with them. I discussed, you know, a few things with that, you know, but practically, no.
And about these thermoplastic processes, sir, which are there?
Thermoplastics are good, you know. We had, you know, one people, Mr. Joshi from Mumbai, in one of our workshops.
Right.
And he told us how to apply different type of splints and all those things.
Right, sir.
Yeah, you can have, the splinting, this is basically splinting. You can apply splint with any of the material.
Right.
Any of the material. Use plaster of Paris, use, you know, this fiberglass, use polyester, use, you know, this 3D or whatever. All of this is splinting.
Absolutely, sir. Absolutely. Perfect, sir. Yeah, Neeraj, over to you.
Yes, sir. So every time I listen to this, I learn something new. So about this, actually, I wanted to ask about the synthetic plasters, but Salim has already asked and you have already answered. So I want to ask you about the cast index.
Yes.
So how important is the cast index in the adult patient? I know that it is very important in the pediatric patients' forearm fractures.
Yes. No, not forearm fracture. I have already told, you know, discussed in my talk. It has to be, you know, applied everywhere. Now, it depends on the, you know, what is the shape of your limb, you know.
Okay.
Why I say 1.2 in the leg, because the diameter there, anterior posterior diameter is more as compared to the lateral diameters, lateral dimension. So it is equally important in adults and children, no doubt. So even if we are applying Coley's cast, the example which I have shown you, if you keep it round, don't do this indexing, then we are going to lose the reduction. So it has to maintain that, you know, shape of the limb. We have to maintain the shape of the forearm. It is oval. It is not round. If it is round, it means it's loose. So it is equally important in adults.
And about the close reduction, sometimes we do close reductions in a pediatric patient or in Coley's fracture. And the swelling comes down after 4 to 5 days or a week. And then the cast becomes loose. So would you recommend to repeat the cast, change the cast?
Yes, absolutely, yes. Whenever there is a loose cast or break cast, always change it.
Okay.
No fun keeping the loose cast. So that is why whenever there is a trauma, initial few days, we apply slab and then we go for a definitive cast. Maybe 3-4 days only. Maybe 3-4 days. Maybe a week, no problem. And another important thing, you know, you have, you know, touched synthetic cast. We should not apply synthetic cast in acute setting. Never. Should not do that. Okay, this is very, very important. If you do that, then it does not compensate for the swelling and the patient will land up in compartment syndromes.
Absolutely. Sir. I agree with you 100%.
And plus what I have seen is that during close reduction, the synthetic cast don't mold so easily as the POP mold.
Yes, it is not pliable. No, it is not pliable. It does not mold. So apply it when you change the cast. See, in a colleague's cast, what I'm doing is apply cast for 2 days after the reduction, plaster of Paris, and then when you are changing it, change it to synthetic after 2 weeks. What is the problem?
And the continuation of the cast. So do you, especially in a colleague's fracture, do you keep it for 6 weeks, 4 weeks?
My principles are very clear, you know. I keep 2 weeks in a flex position and then I change it to the neutral for another 4 weeks, 6 weeks, absolute.
Total 6 weeks.
Yes.
Okay. Have you recently used PTB cast in the last 1 year?
Not PTB. I use all type of cast. PTB I routinely use.
Okay.
This is a functional cast bracing. Very important, very good for the fracture healing. We are going to have some talk on functional cast bracing. I have a full talk on that.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, sir. I think that's all from our side tonight. And let's hope that we have you the functional cast bracing talk ready very soon.
So many talks on plaster, maybe complications next time. Complications. I think with this, you should have complications first.
Right.
Absolutely.
Sure, sir. So we'll have a whole series on plaster cast then.
No problem. Anytime.
Thank you very much. Bye. We thank Dr. Rajesh Gupta to spare his time.
Thank you very much. It is my honor, you know.
And above all, we thank the audience who have been there with us since the last almost now 10 months since the lockdown.
We know.
Hopefully the vaccine brings us out of this and we meet everyone physically.
Yes,
thank you, everyone, and good night.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.